Bose, she's probably one of the early, extremely early workers in this area of quantum information theory. And always having one leg in the experimental things. Why do I say that? Because if you see, you know, this people are talking about internal, you know, path degree of freedom, entangled with, you know, photon spin degree of freedom. And, you know, he was sort of with it quite some time back. If you see, you know, his scientific contribution is quite enormous in the sense that some of these remarkable experiments, you know, for example, fluid measurement, Bohmian trajectory by Steinberg, University of Toronto. Then this Deepankar-Hom and Partho Bose, you know, that was the time when they had gone to Hyderabad. I think Deepankar had gone, if I remember, Professor Agarwal always mentions about that. That was also very verified experimentally, passed in Japan. So quite a, and now, for example, is you talk to him, the classical quantum correspondence is internal degree and you know, path of the same field being entangled. All those things are quite counterintuitive and they have been keeping him busy. In addition, if you check out, Professor Bose, for example, has done an enormous amount of work for popularization of science. During our time, you know, this BBC, the science program, then I think Doordarshan also, if I remember correctly. Those days I was not in India, but you know, he was very, very popular. He was a professor in S.N. Bose. And in addition, he had tremendous amount of interest and contribution to cultural and other kind of aspects. See, for example, he is most friendly to ICER. You know, we love to hear from him about you know this Renaissance in Bengal, where he gives you a picture of what was happening in the country, how the society evolved, and the science kept pace with it. A remarkable amount of science was done. Something if you find you know some time, is go through his things and it may be very relevant. Now, in addition, you can see. For example, he's associated with this center, it has been there for some time now, Tagore Center for National Sciences and Philosophy, combining you know, combining science and philosophy in the spirit of Tagore. If you're curious, you know, when I came here, I thought Tagore was a personality only for literature, but Timothy Tagore was amazing. You know, he has, you know, this book, if I remember correctly, he has this science book, which is very well written. So, and so without much ado, I will request Professor Bose to start his thing. And as we go along, we can stop him because, you know, he's, you know, these things may not be familiar to you. This, but these are actually the notations, for example, this four vector notation. Half essence, the same polarization of light. You need the four vector because, you know, although we describe it as four objects, that's not really correct. So now, Professor Bose, you can start your talk.
Thank you very much, Professor Panigrahi, for your very kind words of introduction. As he has indicated, I'll talk to you about an emerging area of classical optics, which involves essentially the idea of entanglement. Though there is some debate as to whether this entanglement is the same as quantum entanglement. However, we will go through this and then you can make up your own minds. So let us start with the electromagnetic four vector potential, which all of you must be familiar with. Some four vector MUX, which is written as I have indicated here, as an integral over some k value, k being essentially the momentum, but the wave vector. This is actually a relativistically invariant expression. And this epsilon mu is the polarization vector, and it's summed over two values, one and two, because of the fact that electromagnetic waves are only transversely polarized. And then you have some Fourier component, and you have this expression where kx I write as k0 x0 minus k dot x. Now, these are the only two physical degrees of freedom. There are two others because it's a four vector. But they are the longitudinal component and the time component, and gauge invariance makes sure that they cancel out. So I'm not going into those details. I'm sure most of you must have gone through that in your electrodynamics courses. And these satisfy this orthogonality condition. Now, this mu is a classical potential function if this phi, the Fourier component, is a C number function of k. And it is an operator if this phi is an operator. So when one usually one goes from the classical field to a quantum field, this phi is made into an operator. And so this also becomes an operator. But in classical electromagnetic theory, these are functions. Now look carefully at this expression. You will notice that you cannot factorize the polarization and the propagation part. So it is not a product state. This is the usual expression one is familiar with. Already here you can see that there is some kind of entanglement between the polarization and the propagation mode. Now, this is obviously true whether you are in classical optics or in quantum QVD, quantum optics. So what does that mean? So see, the space, the propagation part, which is a scalar, which involves space and time, and the polarization, which involves the electric, the components of the electric field, they are two different Hilbert spaces altogether. And in this particular example, these two Hilbert spaces are not separable. So when one talks about entanglement, in general, one means the absence of factorizability. So in that sense, this is also as entangled as in quantum physics. Now, supposing you take a beam of light, white light, which is represented by that equation, because it's integrated over all values of k, so it's a wave packet. And you, it's, supposing you place a lens so that the light comes out as a beam, parallel beam, and you place a color filter. What will happen? The emerging light will be colored. Supposing you take a blue filter, then the emerging light will be blue. And tagged with it will be a particular polarization which occurs in this integral. So that light will be polarized. And you can vary the polarization. Nothing will happen to the path. So in that case, that light, which has a specific polarization, is in a factored state. So it is not entangled. But the wave packet which you construct from such unentangled components becomes entangled in the end. Now, this brings out a very new feature of classical electrodynamics, namely contextuality. Now, what does that mean? I'll come back to this later, but basically the polarization and color of light are contextual. That means it depends on what context you see that light. The classical reality can be, the fact that classical reality can be contextual was not realized earlier. I'll again come back to this, but let's just recall that in the 1920s, Mr. C.V. Raman was traveling to Europe across the Mediterranean. He had with him some nickel prisms and so on, polarizers, and he was looking at the blue light coming out of the sea, which is scattered, like light scattered by the water. And he found that the pure blue light was polarized, whereas the incident white light, sunlight, was not. And that set him thinking about all these things. And eventually, of course, he experimented with lots of liquids and so on, and eventually found his the famous Raman effect. So why I am saying this is that even simple things like looking at the light from the sea can lead to very fundamental discoveries if your theoretical ideas are sound. You know what you can correctly interpret what you are observing. So the polarization and the frequency of light are related in this way. The fact that they are related has been known for a long time, but that is connected with entanglement is a recent realization. So let us briefly go through the properties of Hilbert spaces, particularly this famous theorem, the Schmidt decomposition theorem, which is the mathematical basis of entanglement. So let's look at some examples of Hilbert spaces. What are Hilbert spaces? Now, I don't want to go into very mathematical details. I am assuming that most of you are already familiar with this. So let me just quickly go through the basic ideas. Hilbert spaces are basically complex linear spaces with a norm and also an inner product. Some examples are given to emphasize that they are not specific to quantum mechanics. The way quantum mechanics and classical mechanics are usually taught gives the impression that Hilbert spaces come in only when you talk about quantum mechanics. That is absolutely wrong. Hilbert spaces were known, Hilbert had given his theory of these spaces much before quantum mechanics was even born. And the Schmidt decomposition theorem was found in way back in 1907 when there was no quantum mechanics. So Hilbert spaces occur in classical physics as well as in mathematics. One example is this Rn with the dot or scalar product of the n basis vectors. That is the real vector space. It can also be the Cn with the dot products of the basis vectors and their Hermitian transposes, like this. Also, the space CAB of complex valued functions, continuous functions, in this interval AB, endowed with an inner product which is defined like this. F of G is integral F bar or F star X GX DX, where F and G are continuous functions. And the norm is given by this, and it is finite. It has to be finite for a Hilbert space. So these spaces are denoted by the symbol L square AB, and they're called square integrable functions. Unlike Rn and Cn, which are finite dimensional, that is n is usually runs from 1, 2, 3, 4, then is denumerable. These functions are not denumerable in that sense, and so therefore they're infinite dimensional spaces. Examples are, for example, L square in the interval minus to plus 1 with Legendre polynomials as orthonormal basis functions, L square minus infinity to plus infinity with Hermite polynomials as orthonormal basis functions, and L square 0 to plus infinity with Laguerre polynomials as orthonormal basis functions. Such spaces were discovered much before the advent of quantum mechanics. For example, as you all know, the Legendre polynomials occur in the calculation of potentials in classical electrostatics and Newton's law of gravitation. In mathematics, the Hermite polynomials have been known to arise in probability theory and numerical analysis as Gaussian quadrature. They are also used in systems theory in connection with nonlinear operations or Gaussian noise and other sciences. The study of Laguerre polynomials in the 19th century laid the foundations of contemporary optical communications. Now, you these days you have these vortex beams in which the Laguerre polynomial plays a role. These spaces are also they find many applications in quantum mechanics as well, as you all know. Now, what is the Schmidt decomposition theorem? Suppose there is a bipartite classical state like this in this Kronecker product Hilbert space HA times HB, and HB and HB are Hilbert space. Then according to the Schmidt decomposition theorem, which, as I said, dates back to 1907, it is always possible to express this state in this form, where this lambda subscript I are real and strictly positive, and they satisfy this condition. Just one moment. আমি একটা সেমিনারে আছি এখন হ্যালো সরি দিস আই এ আই বি দিস আর দি অর্থোনর্মাল অর্থোনর্মাল বেসিস ইন দিস হিলবার্ট স্পেসেস নাও দ্য স্মিট র্যাঙ্ক ডি অফ আ বাইপার্টাইট স্টেট ইজ ইকুয়াল টু দ্য নাম্বার অফ স্মিট কোএফিশিয়েন্টস ল্যামডা আই ইন দিস ডিকম্পোজিশন. And it satisfies this thing, this relation. Now, if the Schmidt rank D is greater than 1, then the state is called entangled. That is, it cannot be factorized. In classical optics, it is always possible to consider the light of unit intensity without implying normalization in the same sense as quantum mechanics. Hence, this mathematical result, that is the Schmidt decomposition theorem, equation 5, this is equally applicable to classical and quantum mechanical optics. Now, the two Hilbert spaces, HA and HB, in the Schmidt decomposition have disjoint bases. There is obviously nothing in the mathematical theorem that tells us how the disjointness is to be physically realized. Now, there are two types of entanglement. One type is called the intra-system bipartite entanglement. That is entanglement between two different degrees of freedom of a single system. One can have, for example, path polarization entanglement in classical optics and path spin entanglement in quantum mechanics, where the choice of paths, or strictly speaking, disjoint spatial modes, is restricted to two, that is, two paths with two orthogonal polarizations. For inter-system entanglement, that is, two different systems, one can have polarization-polarization entanglement in both classical and quantum optics, the dimensions of the Hilbert spaces being two in both cases. Now, in this case, the spatial wave function of the two systems remain in product form. It's only the polarization which get entangled. Now, so far, only intra-system entanglement has been experimentally explored in practical optics. But extension to inter-system entanglement is possible in principle. In quantum mechanics, of course, inter-system entanglement is the one which has been most extensively studied, leading to the idea of non-locality. I will come back to that later. It's a very interesting and deep thing. Now, it should be clear, therefore, from what I have said, that the mathematical structure of entanglement is fundamentally the same for classical and quantum mechanical radiation. Though, because of the normalization of the quantum states forced by the Planck constant, projective measurements play a role in quantum radiation that has no counterpart in classical radiation. So there are certain technical differences. Now, to explore this idea of particularly intrastate bipartite entanglement, let's consider what are called Jones vectors and polarization. Now, consider a monochromatic beam of light of angular frequency omega propagating along the z or z axis of a Cartesian frame of reference, xyz, and polarization in the xy plane, that is orthogonal to the propagation direction, because that is how classical light is. Now, in the paraxial approximation to the Helmholtz equation, I presume you know what the Helmholtz equation is. It's the Laplacian square plus some k square operating on the wave function is zero, where k is omega divided by c. So that's the Helmholtz equation. Now, if you do a paraxial approximation, that is a slightly divergent beam, then the electric field can be written as the electric field, the function of R and T, is a real part of this expression where ER, the spatial part, is given like this with a scalar wave function psi of the radius vector and the two polarizations like this. This is the unit polarization in the x direction, and that is the unit polarization in the y direction. And there is, of course, the z direction, which is orthogonal to the propagation. These are the unit vectors. Now, in this expression, R is the radius vector. And there are two complex numbers, A0 and A1. They represent the amplitudes of the electric field along the x and y axis. Now, a convenient vector notation for fields of this form was introduced by R.C. Jones in the 1940s. He wrote E of R not in this form, but in this form, where the first factor is the contains the two components of the electric field, which correspond to the polarization, and then the scalar, which is the same as this, where A0 is Ex and A1 is Ey. Now, this makes the identification of the polarization and the scalar wave quite transparent. So you can see that this is actually a product state. This is not an entangled state. So in this form, the polarization and the propagation degrees of freedom are clearly in a product form and therefore not entangled. However, this is not true in general. For example, if in the paraxial approximation of the Helmholtz equation, where we saw the E comes in a slightly different form, and if you have a non-uniformly polarized beam, normally we deal with uniformly polarized beam. That is, if you take a cross section, the polarization is the same everywhere. But you can have beams, particularly these vortex beams, where the polarization is not uniform across a particular plane perpendicular to the propagation. then the electric vector can be written in a general form like this. Something A00, unit vector EX, I10, then A01 EX, Psi01. That is, there are two independent psi functions which are solutions. So this psi MN with MN, you know, in the range 1, 2, etc., these are the Hermite-Gauss solutions of the paraxial equation. So you can have this, or you can have another combination with the EYs. So this is a non-uniformly polarized state, where the electric vector is given like this. And these A's are all complex amplitudes. Now, in supposing you put it in the Jones notation, then this takes either of the two following forms. The same thing can be written like this or like this. See here, Psi10, Psi01. Psi10, Psi01. So here you have this combination or that combination, which can then again be written like this. Now, once it is written like this, you can see that the first form shows that the polarization is non-uniform because the Jones vector varies with the position vector. The second form shows that the polarization and the spatial degrees of freedom are non-separable or entangled, because one needs two coordinate independent Jones vectors, this and that, and two independent scalar fields, which are Hermite-Gauss solutions. Now, to be specific, let us consider what is called a radially polarized beam of light, which is represented by this. One can obtain this by putting A00 equal to A11 and equal to 1 by root 2, and A10 and A01, these two are zero. Then that becomes a particular type of polarization, entanglement. And supposing we say that EX, the unit polarization vector in the X direction, we just call zero of polarization, and the other one, EY, we call the one vector of polarization. And similarly, zero space is this Psi10, the one vector of space is this other one, Psi01. Then this radially polarized state can be written in this notation like a Bell state. It is isomorphic to a Bell state. It is not a Bell state in the physical sense, but it is mathematically isomorphic. So you have two qubits. Hence, the spatial and polarization degrees of freedom can be treated as two qubits that are classically entangled. The only difference is that in a two-photon Bell state, the two qubits encode the polarization degrees of freedom of two spatially separated photons. Whereas in the radial polarization case, the two qubits they encode the spatial and polarization degrees of freedom of the same beam. This is why the former is often called the interstate entanglement and the latter intrastate entanglement. There is thus a four-dimensional two-qubit Hilbert space, E equal EH2, which is the direct product of the polarization Hilbert space and the spatial Hilbert space in classical optics, The polarization Hilbert space is given by this EXU, a span of EXY, and the other space, the spatial part, is given by these solutions. So just as there is both interstate and intrastate entanglement in quantum mechanics, there can be both these types of entanglement in classical optics also. But as I have said, so far only the intrastate entanglement has been studied in classical optics. Now, there are three types of intrastate entanglement in classical optics. It could be polarization position, as we showed examples of radial and azimuthal. Radial means when you have the cross section, the polarizations are like this, radial. Or it could be azimuthal also. You can also have polarization spatial entanglement. As I said, if you have a beam splitter, then the beam goes in two ways, and you can rotate the polarization in one beam so that they are orthogonal. Such states also exist in quantum mechanics. You can have a neutron coming, and you have some neutron beam splitter. It splits into two bits. Then you can flip the spin in one, and then that is a quantum mechanical thing, which Professor Rauch and his group worked with in Vienna, and that was proposed by Dipankar-Holm and his group. So, you can also have position-position entanglement. I'll not go into these details. I'll later on try and give you some references. You can look them up. Now, I talked about contextuality. Now, what is contextuality? You know already from quantum mechanics that this is a very important concept. But what does it really mean? Well, and also I would like to see whether classical optical beams are necessarily non-contextual. Now, the conventional classical notion of non-contextuality is that a physical property is independent of the context in which it is measured. It has always been a tenet of classical physical science that whatever exists in the physical world is independent of our observation, our observations only serve to reveal what is there. Einstein used to call it's the world out there. And he believed in that kind of reality, which is independent of the observer. Now, if we want to make it a little more technical, then we can say that what this means is that the result of a measurement is predetermined and is not affected by how the value is measured. That is not affected by previous or simultaneous measurement of some other compatible or co-measurable observable. That is the meaning of non-contextuality. Now, to test this classical concept, one has to perform joint measurements of compatible observables that are not necessarily spatially separated. And then this can be done for a classical light by making a joint measurement of its two otherwise independent degrees of freedom, namely the spatial and the polarization degrees of freedom. Now, what this means is that if I measure the polarization degree, the other one is not affected, and vice versa. That would be the case of non-contextuality, as is obviously true for non-entangled states of light, classical light. Suppose you may take a separable state like this, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 0, and 1, 1. This is non-contextual. And one can show, I'm not going into the details, one can show that this satisfies CHSH-like inequality. Clauser, Horn, Shimoni, Holt. On the other hand, a Bell state like 15, which we showed 0, 0 plus 1, 1, like this one, that we know will violate the CHSH type of inequality. Now, in classical optics, exactly the same thing happens. Although the two are not spatially separated, they are parts of the same beam, the two different degrees of freedom. So measurement of one affects the other. So if you measure polarization, the spatial part will be affected. Now this can be shown beautifully. It was shown to me by in PRL, where they have a vortex beam which is which has this non-uniform polarization. If you put a polarized and you project it on the screen on a wall, then you see some shape with a darkness at the center. That is why they're called vortex beams. There's a singularity there. Now, if you put a polarization in the path and you rotate the polarization, you will see the shape changing. It's very, very beautiful and very simple experiment. I had suggested this idea to them and they did it, and I was absolutely delighted to see such a simple demonstration of contextuality in classical optics. Now, interestingly, this so-called non-locality in the typical EPR case can also be interpreted in terms of contextuality or complementarity, the two being essentially the same. This is indeed what Bohr meant in his answer to the EPR paper. As you know, Bohr wrote a counter to the famous EPR paper with the same title in Physical Review in the same year, 1935. Where he contested the idea that what they had demonstrated necessarily meant that quantum mechanics was incomplete. So he used the idea of contextuality and complementarity. So let's examine this a little more carefully. You see, the original EPR paper, as it appears in Physical Review, was actually written only by Podolsky. And Einstein distanced himself from that later on because he thought that the real thing that he was trying to say got buried in all that erudition, I mean, all those definitions of elements of reality and all that. That's all very confusing and it's not even necessary. Later on, he gave a very simple exposition of what he meant. And it appears in his autobiographical notes, which is there in that famous volume called Albert Einstein, Philosopher, Scientist, edited by Schilp. There you will find this argument. And let me just go through it. Suppose you have two systems, A and B. They interact for a short while and then they separate out so that they are, according to quantum mechanics, spatially separated and non-interactive. That's a very important point. Once they're separated out, they're non-interacting. There's no interaction between them. So that if you do something to this one, the other one can never be affected, no matter how long you wait, because there is no interaction. Nothing will propagate from one to the other. People put it as these days as spatial, space-like separation. Einstein didn't use this word. He simply said it is spatial and non-interacting. Now, when you do an experiment, of course, then you have to ensure that they are spatially separated so that nothing goes from one to the other. But conceptually, when you define the problem, then you need not bring in relativity at all. Because once you have two systems which are spatially separated, then this spatial, it's a relativistically invariant concept anyway. So two systems A and B, which are spatially separated and non-interactive. Okay. So if one makes a measurement, a certain measurement on A, then the system B is found in a particular state, say phi B. If, however, one makes a different measurement, which is incompatible with the first on A, then according to quantum mechanics, that Bell state or the EPR state, the system B is in it has a different wave function, some phi prime of B. Which is fine. But now you must hold on to one thing. And he says, he makes basically the reality and locality assumption that no matter what you do on the system A, the factual situation, that is the real situation of B, cannot depend on what is measured on A. Now, if this is true, then quantum mechanics assigns two different wave functions to the same system, which makes it incomplete. Because quantum mechanics says that to every system there is a unique wave function. But now we find, according to quantum mechanics, this is not true. So it's kind of a contradiction, but they put it more mildly, it's incompleteness. So that's it. Nothing more is required. Now, most physicists concluded from this that quantum mechanics is non-local, which means this assumption of Einstein that when you do something to A, nothing happens to B is obviously not true in nature, which means there is some kind of non-locality. Now, Bell also brought this to a climax. He reinforced this by using not quantum mechanics directly, but hidden variables, which are supposed to be classical. And these hidden variables, if you have certain types of hidden variables, which are local and non-contextual, then you get Bell's theorem. It's the same thing as the CHSH type of inequality, Bell's inequality. Now, we have already seen that non-contextuality is not necessarily an aspect of classical reality. Because in classical optics, they are real beams, which you can see directly. And they are contextual. So there is some problem with Bell's idea. But Bohr had a completely different take on this. If you read his paper, then you will find a statement which goes like this. Of course, there is in this case, like that just considered, no question of a mechanical disturbance of the system under investigation during the last critical stage of the measuring device. If I measure something on A, there's no way any mechanical disturbance can go from one to the other. Bohr admits that. But even at this stage, there is essentially the question of an influence on the very conditions which define the possible types of predictions regarding the future behavior of the system. Now, this is typically Bohr's very convoluted way of writing English. In fact, it reminds me, once I had gone to Professor Bose, who was my teacher's advisor, and he gave me, he was reminiscing about his time in Europe and Niels Bohr and so on. And he said, look, I take this paper of Niels Bohr. And he smiled and he said, I don't know what he writes, what he means, but have a go. So this is one example of what he says. But essentially, I think what he means is contextuality, that your experimental conditions define what you can see. Well, in the abstract, he writes, in this connection, a viewpoint termed complementarity is explained from which quantum mechanical description of physical phenomena would seem to fulfill within its scope all rational demands of completeness. That is, once you admit that what you see in reality is context dependent, then this what you find is a very satisfactory complete physical description. So we know today that complementarity and contextuality are intimately related. Now, to make it clear, think of the double slit experiment in which the wave and particle aspects are observed in two mutually exclusive and complementary experimental arrangements. Namely, both slits open and only one slit opens. Now, you cannot have these at the same time. They are mutually incompatible. And so, once you have two slits open, you see an interference pattern. Once you have only one slit open, you only see a single slit diffraction, which is usually called particle-like behavior. It's actually not. So the conventional notion that a physical property must be independent of the context in which it is measured is not supported by empirical evidence. Hence, the fact that quantum mechanics assigns two different wave functions to the same system B in two different and incompatible contexts is just an example of this contextual character, which is perfectly reasonable. In my humble opinion, sorry, something wrong. Hello.
Yeah, you are audible.
Yeah, okay. I don't know where I've lost my paper. Anyway, there's not much more to say. So basically, if you accept the idea of the reality being contextual, then this problem of non-locality actually disappears. You don't say it is non-local. Niels Bohr never admitted non-locality. That is why Hilde's interpretation is quite different from what is usually called the Copenhagen interpretation, which is that of others. So in the case of classical optics also, there is this contextuality, which is evident from the kind of entanglement you see in classical, especially prepared classical beams of light. Okay, thank you. I don't think I should say anything more. Hello.
Thank you, Professor Ghose, for an extremely transparent illustration of the basic principles, you know, which has been, for around 50, 60 years, kept the physics community, grilled, sort of, quantum mechanics has been very mysterious. To my mind, the way you explained, it really brought out the basic aspects. Now the session is open for questions. If somebody has a question. Now this, can I ask you a little bit about the Bohmian trajectory?
There was no connection with what I just now said. Yeah, I can. Should I?
Because we have time. It would be very nice if you...
Yes. Unfortunately, I'm unable to write anything.
No, just can't tell. Yeah.
But I have to only speak.
Yeah.
You see, in quantum mechanics, let us just stick to non-relativistic quantum mechanics. So you have the Schrodinger equation. So you have a psi function. Now, this psi function can be written in the form of some function, say rho of x, times an exponential I times some function S divided by H bar, where S is the action function. So supposing I write psi in this form and I substitute this in the wave in the Schrodinger equation, then if you separate the real part and the imaginary part, you'll get two different equations. The second equation is the usual continuity equation, that is the del rho del t plus divergence of something equal to zero. But the first equation is very interesting. The first equation is the almost the classical Hamilton-Jacobi equation, that is the time derivative of the S function plus some Hamiltonian equal to zero. But this Hamiltonian is grad S square by 2m, where grad S is the momentum, plus the external potential V, plus you get an extra term, which is called the quantum potential. And the expression for it is minus h bar square over 2m del square rho over rho. Now, this is just simple mathematics. You write psi in terms of rho and s, put it into the wave Schrodinger equation, and out comes this Hamilton-Jacobi type of equation with the difference that there is an extra term in the Hamiltonian. And that term with an extra potential has come to be known as the quantum potential. Now, so far, there's nothing new. This is just plain quantum mechanics. What Bohm did is to say that he defined gradient of the scalar function as the momentum. Now, in quantum mechanics, there is no momentum. There's only a momentum operator. So here is now you have, following classical ideas, gradient of S. In classical mechanics also, we know that gradient of S is the momentum. So you write that. And if you put into this Hamilton-Jacobi equation, you can show that you get Newton's second law. That is the second derivative, d2p dt2, that is second time derivative of the momentum, is minus gradient of the potential. But now in the potential, there is a V plus a Q. And therefore, the trajectories that you calculate from such an equation of motion will be different from the classical trajectories. So these are called the Bohmian trajectories.
And recently, you have been also coming up with a new idea regarding this, you know, quote unquote, you know, classical wave function kind of thing. You know, that can we tell a little bit about? You know, recently, you have been thinking of interpreting this, you know, classical mechanics in a different way.
Yeah.
I hope you are getting me. I saw your recent paper.
Yeah, you mean the Hilbert space representation of classical mechanics?
Yeah,
which is not new. This was done by von Neumann and Koopman in the 1930s. They showed how to write classical mechanics in Hilbert space. What they did was they took a psi function, psi of x, as well as p. In quantum mechanics, you can't write that. In quantum mechanics, psi is only a function of x. P is just a parameter. But they wrote a psi of x and p, which is therefore a Hilbert space wave-like representation of classical mechanics. And then they postulated an equation of motion for that psi, which is the Liouville equation for psi as well as psi star. If you do that, you will find that unlike in usual wave optics or even quantum Schrodinger equation, the phase and the amplitude, they don't evolve independently. They're coupled. That is why you see interference patterns. But if you do it in the Koopman von Neumann way, then these two get decoupled. And you get a usual phase space representation.
Mm-hmm.
So you can have a Hilbert space representation of classical mechanics, but the equation of motion is not Schrödinger, it's Liouville. There have been other attempts also to write a Schrödinger-like equation and not following Koopman and von Neumann, but write a Schrödinger equation, but with an extra potential, which is the negative of the quantum potential.
Okay.
Then when you do that transformation to psi equal to rho e to the power is, then you will find that you will get the classical Hamilton equation. The Q will cancel. So you can write what is called a classical Schrödinger equation. But then this classical Schrödinger equation, because it has a Q, which is psi dependent, it becomes nonlinear.
Okay. So are there any more questions?
Are there any versions of hidden variable theories in the relativistic framework?
Your sound is not audible. Maybe you can read it from somebody can read it from here.
Yeah.
Yes.
Are there any versions of hidden variable theories in the relativistic framework?
Sarang, you're not audible. Can you write it in the chat box?
Something about relativity.
So the question is, are there any versions of hidden variable theories in relativistic framework?
Yes, there are. But I can't go into the details right now, but there are many attempts. In fact, Dipankar Hom, I, and later on others like Harchand Majumdar and Jaideep Sahu and others, we developed a relativistic way of doing Bohmian mechanics, in particular massless, that is for electrodynamics. And we calculated this Bohmian trajectory. Paper was published in physics letters A, and it's one of my papers which has been most among my papers. This is one of the most highly quoted. We had done it in I think 2001, but much later Steinberg and his group, they actually performed experiments to plot Bohmian trajectories of photons. And they found exactly the trajectories that we had predicted, and in their original expositions in several conferences, they quoted us. But in the final paper, for some reason, they did not. But it remains one of, I mean, a lot of people just quote our paper. So there is this way of doing it. I have, since then, I have developed a better way of doing it. The same thing. So the problem with our formulation at that time was that I used a very unknown, sophisticated equation, which is called the them, the famous Indian mathematician.
Harishchandra. Is it Harishchandra?
The Harishchandra equation we had used, which is a very complicated equation. First of all, he used what is called the Kemmer equation. But Kemmer equation is for massive fields. Then he showed how to do it for massless. And we use that. And that's a very, you know, it's a 10 component equation, and the matrices are these 10 by 10 beta matrices whose algebra is quite different from the Dirac algebra. So now this is not necessary to do all that. There are other simple ways of doing the same thing. But at that time, that was the only thing I knew, and we enjoyed working with Harishchandra's ideas. It's a very, very dense and very difficult to understand paper.
Okay, look, there are. Can you shed some light on Cochin?
Incidentally, just before I leave this question, the Bohmian trajectories for Dirac equation have also been done.
Oh, I see.
Yeah. So.
That's interesting. When was it done? Which year?
Which one?
Dirac equation.
Oh, a long time back. It's paper by, you know, Peter Holland and his group there in England. That's two or three others. Long time back.
But no experiments have been done, or has it been done?
Sorry?
I said, like this Steinberg's experiment, are there any experiments on Dirac equation?
No, the experiment, but that was with photons.
Yeah. No, in the Steinberg's thing was experimental measurement. Yeah, for Dirac equation, yeah.
Dirac equation experimental, experimental determination of Bohmian trajectories for Dirac electrons. That I don't think, I have not seen any.
There is one more question. Can you shed some light on Cochin spector theorem? How it is actually different from Bell's original theorem?
What is it?
How is it Cochin spector theorem, and how is it different from Bell's original theorem?
The Cochin spector is a different thing altogether. It has nothing to do with Bell's theorem. I think that is Cochin. There is something to do with contextuality, right? Cochin spector theorem tells you that quantum mechanics is essentially contextual. That is, non-contextuality is inconsistent with quantum mechanics. If I remember correctly.
Okay, so there are two more questions. So thank you, Professor Ghosh. Very illuminating talk.
Thank you. But I wish there were more questions on the classical entanglement.
Yeah, young people, you know, these foundation aspects and things, you know, it will take some while before it goes into their head. Only recently, I am able to follow some of it because they're highly, you know, intricate. You have to be really involved with it.
There is a paper by Arvind Mukunda and so on this classical entanglement. Like I'll tell you, if the students go through that paper, they will learn a lot.
Okay, so I'll bring I'll show that thing to them. I'll bring it to their attention.
Yeah. Well, thank you very much, Prashant, for giving me this opportunity to be with physics again after a long time.
Yeah. Yeah. You know, I mean,
not that I don't do physics. I have been doing physics, but not lecturing and so on.
Yeah, because I have also kept track of your work. So
I've recently written a paper with a student at Essen Bose Center. He's also Partha Nandi. And if you give me 5 minutes, I'll just say
how excited
I am.
Yeah, yeah.
You see, suppose you take an ordinary wave equation, that is box acting on psi of x is zero. It's a massless equation, which means the Laplacian square minus 1 by c square, del square del t square, operating on psi is zero. Now, if you take psi as what is called a stationary state, that is the dependence, the time dependence is only in the exponential. And then just take one time derivative. Then you will get a minus, so therefore the exponential is some, it says psi of x is some psi of spatial x, that is x, y, z, times e exponential minus I omega t. Now this is all classical. I take only one time derivative of this, then I'll get a minus I omega and times del psi del t, and that will be equal to del square on psi. This is exactly the Schrodinger equation. You have one time derivative of psi related to the Laplacian acting on psi. There's some constants which you have to put in. You multiply the whole thing by h bar and so on, and you can put it exactly in the Schrodinger form, which will be I h bar d psi dt equal to minus h bar square over twice m star. I'll tell you what m star is, times del square psi. But m star is nothing but h nu by twice c. So this is a relativistic Schrodinger equation. If you take a second, if you evaluate this time derivative again, then you get the Helmholtz equation, which is all again classical. It's very interesting. When I was actually trying to deduce the Helmholtz equation from the full wave equation. And when I took one time derivative and I looked at it, I was absolutely stunned to see the Schrodinger structure there. So I if you remember, I gave this lecture in Bangalore at a conference at the Raman Institute.
Yes. Yes.
And since then, I have been working on this. There were certain doubts raised about relativistic invariance and so on, so forth. I've taken care of all that. I've now written it. And lo and behold, when I sent a copy to my friend Unnikrishnan, he said, but this is exactly what Schrodinger did in 1926. He said, how come? He sent me this paper of Schrodinger written in 1926, published in Physical Review, where towards the end, he does exactly the same. Except that he does it in the non-relativistic way.
Mm-hmm.
He says, you see, take one time derivative and you get my equation.
Mm-hmm.
And now, you see, I've put that into the paper saying I'm just following Schrodinger. Because everybody, when I said take one time derivative, you get this equation, people were not convinced. Some, you know, why should I take one time derivative? Why should I not take two time derivative? You know, ideas like that. But my idea is also the same. What's wrong with taking the first time derivative and looking at that equation? It happens to be the Schrodinger equation. So now we have a connection between classical and quantum. There's one difference, however, and that's a crucial difference. The crucial difference is that the psi function, which is the solution of the Schrodinger-like equation, and the psi, which is a solution of the Helmholtz equation, differ in one respect. For Helmholtz type equation, del square on the rho, which is the amplitude part, has to be zero. Has to be, it's by mathematics. Whereas in the intermediate equation, which is the Schrodinger equation, that is not zero. And that is precisely the quantum potential. So there is an inherent built-in connection between classical and quantum physics. In the relativistic field case, it's fantastic. And you can build a theory which unifies classical and quantum mechanics in this way, that is, usually people of the Schrodinger equation to go to the classical case. What I'm saying is that is not necessary. All you need to do is choose a wave function which satisfies this condition, and then you'll get classical. Equations are the same. Not only that, you start with this complex psi function, which is a scalar wave. And as I showed you, you can construct a four-vector potential by just inserting a polarization. So you can construct the electromagnetic field from it. We've shown that not only that, you can also construct a complex four-vector potential, which is the gauge representation of general relativity in the linear approximation. So from the same psi function, you get the classical wave, the quantum mechanical wave, you can construct, by taking the real part, you can construct electrodynamics, and by taking the full complex part, you can construct linearized gravity. So everything is unified. The difference between classical and quantum simply being in the condition that the wave function satisfies. That's all. I'm very excited. Let us see what happens.
Yeah,
at this old age, I can afford to do these kinds of things. Let me end by saying what my Gurudev, S.N. Bose, told me the very last time I met him. And let me put it in Bengali. I hope most people will understand it. He said, Baba, he used to call me Baba, Nijer moto kore bujhe, notun kichu bolar chesta kor. We Americans are ki bolche seta sob shomoy copy korish na. So I've been trying to follow my Gurudev. I'm trying to understand in my own way, and I'm absolutely delighted with the insights I'm getting.
Thank you so much. I'm pretty sure this kind of things, probably some experimental people will take it up.
I hope so. Because what we have done is also to show that if gravity is quantized, whatever you see, in terms of gravitational waves, the perihelion motion of Mercury, the bending of light around the sun, they are all in the linear approximation to the full gravitational theory. And so all this is covered here. And the redshift as well. What was I going to say? Yes. So the question is, these gravitational waves which are detected, do they carry any signature which says that they have gravitons in them, or is it fully classical? So now we have shown, by constructing the coherent states of these gravitons, that in the interference pattern, there will be a difference. And this difference comes basically from that quantum potential type of term, which is the quantum noise. So therefore, in the detector, you will have a quantum noise. If you can pick it up, then you will have seen gravitons.
It's somewhat like this Hungary ground quiz kind of thing. Somewhat like that intensity correlation in Hungary ground quiz SBT experiment.
Hungary ground. and very brown type.
Yeah.
Yeah, they may be looking for that also.
Mm. Okay, somebody is asking, is it useful to determine direction of time?
Is it useful?
Yeah.
What? Sorry, what is the question?
Is it useful to determine direction of time?
To determine?
Yeah.
Well, it is a very fundamental question. That is, we see time only going one way. Nobody has ever seen time go the other way. But all our fundamental equations are reversible. So there is this question, and people have tried to relate it to quantum measurement and all that. But also, there are various kinds of direction of time. There is this one that you are talking about, probably you mean the time measured by a clock in physics. But there are other directions of time also, like, for example, the second law of thermodynamics also gives you a direction of time, the direction in which entropy increases. There are other psychological directions of time also. It's a very complex issue, and time itself is so difficult to define or understand. One experiences it, that's it. And then one has this variable T in the equations of physics. But exactly what it means is difficult. You know, at one time, when I was studying relativity, and then Minkowski's ways of putting it, four-dimensional world, so X, Y, Z, T, they're all the same. So I was saying something to that effect to Professor Bose, and he smiled and said, it's all wrong. Space and time are quite different. You see, there is a minus sign in the metric. So they are not physically the same. But mathematically, it's a nice way of putting it so that things become very easy to calculate.
Yes.
Time has been one of the most enigmatic things for everybody, physicists, non-physicists, everybody.
You said, you know, this thermodynamics, people have been also, yes, you know, bothered about direction of time. Very fundamental question.
Yes. But you can deduce, you can sort of have some idea from Boltzmann statistics.
Yes.
Where the irreversibility comes. Mm. I had some discussions with George Sudarshan also on this. He was also very intrigued. Mm. Somewhere you have to put it in by hand.
Mm.
It doesn't come out.
Mm. Yeah, so looks like there are no more questions. And thank you, Professor Bose.
There is a question from Mr. Nakamura.
Hello.
Yeah, Professor Nakamura, you want to ask something?
Hello.
I just connected. So I'm giving talk from 3, right?
Yeah,
Yeah.
Okay, so Professor Bose, thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
was here for Aisha. We already have time. 10 minutes.
Okay, 10 minutes, but maybe. Okay, so. Hello, Professor Nakamura, are you there?
Yes, I am.
So, just to check, can you please share your screen?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Can you see it?
Yeah, we can see.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you. Good. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so you can stop sharing for now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Thank you.